Now I'm very pleased to introduce tonight's speakers. Tonight, we welcome Katrina vanden Heuvel, editor and publisher of The Nation. She is a frequent commentator on America and international politics and writes a weekly web column for The Washington Post. Also joining tonight is Didi Guttenplan, who is the author of The Nation, a Biography, tonight's book. He is the magazine's longtime London correspondent and co-editor with Katrina of The Nation's 150th anniversary special issue. They are joined by Chloe Maxmin, a recent Harvard grad and a writer for The Nation, also a co-founder of Divest Harvard. We look forward to their conversation, looking back at the history of America's oldest weekly magazine tonight. On behalf of Harvard Bookstore, please join me in welcoming our panel.
Think about that. It's daunting. It's powerful, it's inspiring. I like to say that The Nation, I think, is one of the few publications that was here for the debut launch of The Telegraph and the launch of Twitter. And in there somehow we found some sanity. But we do plan to be around. You're gonna hear from my co-editor, as Alex said, and my co-conspirator, my collaborator on the 150th special anniversary issue, author of The Nation, Biography, and Chloe Maxmin, who has been one of our terrific student nation correspondents, a leader of the Divest Harvard movement, and much more. So, abolitionists. It was abolitionists committed to ending slavery who founded The Nation on July 6th, 1865. Frederick Law Olmsted, architect of Central Park, among other beautiful parks, was one of the founders, and Don's book is, I would say, the inside story, a riveting story of those abolitionists, young band of abolitionists, and then the radical writers, the free thinkers, the visionaries, the dissidents, the troublemakers, the causes, the controversies, the conflicts, which have made The Nation the publication it is. I think it's fair to say that the story of The Nation is the story of our country. It's not the story you got in your textbooks, and I don't think it's the story a lot of today's students are gonna get in textbooks if they're edited out of Texas, which is, seems where the textbook industry is another project to take on. But it is a story, and Don's book frames this so beautifully. It's a story, as Eric Funder, the historian, writes in our special issue, it's a story about the contested idea of freedom. It is about liberalism, as we have known it over these 150 years. It's about radicalism, and it's very much about the movements and those allies inside the system who have shaped the nation as we know it. Martin Luther King Jr. Was our civil rights correspondent who wrote an annual audit of the civil rights movement from 1961 to 1966. I think it's his last piece and is in the issue, The Last Steep Ascent,
yes,
where he begins to talk about the economic conditions, the economic radicalism that is so often ignored on Martin Luther King Day in this country. Einstein, warning of the nuclear threats, Langston Hughes on the Negro and the racial mountain. Hunter Thompson, you remember him? He wrote his first piece for The Nation on Hell's Angels because The Nation editor at that time sent him the Attorney General's report of California. Ralph Nader wrote his first piece for The Nation, The Safe Car You Can't Buy.
While he was at Harvard.
Well, he was at Harvard Law School, right? He still calls, by the way, every 2 weeks. First to berate me for what we're not doing and then give me great ideas for what we should be doing. He's, you know, you gotta respect this. Molly Ivins, the great Molly Ivins. The Nation has never, yeah. The other Texas, Texas that we will retrieve, but Molly Ivins, we've never been accused of being a humor magazine, though Calvin Trillin has lifted us up, but she, I thought of her the other day when we republished one of her great pieces about Jeb Bush. So many writers, Tony Kushner, Toni Morrison, both in the special issue, one about gay liberation, the other about the role of the artist in a time of fear, E.L. Doctorow on the climate crisis, Alice Walker on what black women seek, Marilynne Robinson on religion. Glorious poems. My co-editor was the poetry editor. I am a Philistine.
If you don't like the poems, you can complain to me.
And of course, the political edge of Don, if it's okay to say, went to see Noam Chomsky today, who wrote about something that's been in the news in the last few days, Magna Carta. And Noam Chomsky in 1993 wrote a cover story for us on NAFTA, which I'm reminded of today because I'm sure some of you have followed what has happened to this corporate-backed trade agreement. I mean, it is a real measure, I think, of our times. But it's that arc of history that the nation has followed, from NAFTA to the protests in Seattle, WTO, so that when this happens today, we place it in a bigger perspective, understanding that the nation, if it plays a role, it's almost kind of a social movement. It changes the way people think if you're doing your job. It changes the narrative. I want to turn to Chloe and Don, but let me just finish by saying one of the other things I found very moving is we asked prominent writers to reflect on those pieces in our archives. Paula Giddings wrote a piece engaging, as we would call it, with Howard Zinn's powerful early piece about the civil rights movement at the historically black women's college in Georgia. Greg Grandin, I don't know if you know him, but he wrote, reflected on William Appleman Williams, a great historian. And the reflection I think is so timely today is how does America, what is its role in the world if it's possible to have that role without being an empire? And that strand of anti-imperialism is one of the enduring strands. I'm sure Don will speak of this because the nation in its early years was full of zigs and zags, but anti-imperialism, and I would argue civil liberties, were consistent themes. Vivian Gornick, a great writer, writing about statelessness and citizenship, riffing, if one can do that, off of Emma Goldman's piece in the 30s. And all along, we have kept our eye out on the future, the radical future. Rebecca Solnit, a beautiful writer on hope, and as I said, Toni Morrison about the future, and Chloe Maxmin, and about six or seven other students reflect on the kind of future they would like to see. Because what we're trying to do in this 150th year is to look forward. We're informed by history, that's the value of the nation, the arc of history, but to look forward, because I think you'd agree that so many of the issues that preoccupied us over these last 150 years are still with us or as pressing. If you think about the arc from, say, anti-communism in the, God, I want to say the 50s, but it was 40s. A broader arc, 30s, 40s, 50s, right. And today Islamophobia, or the relationship of the left to power or concentrated wealth and inequality. These are issues that are as pressing as ever. And also striking, the nation repeatedly championed proposals that at one time seemed heretical, only later, even a generation later, seemed downright commonsensical. In 1954, the nation, in an essay by Bernard Fall, an eminent student of Vietnam, suggested perhaps we might seek a negotiated path out of Vietnam and not a military intervention. And that kind of DNA, that sense of standing tall when others are capitulating to the fear around them, I think animated the nation to be one of the few media publications and standing up to a liberal community as well in opposing the war in Iraq. So, survival is sweet, independence is sweet. Part of that longevity is caring more for what we stand for than what we make. We are a forum for passionate arguments at our best between liberals, radicals, conservatives with a conscience, anarchists. And we are for exposing and criticizing, but always trying to propose alternatives, because I think the nation at its best is about alternatives to what can be stigmatized or isn't being discussed in the mainstream media. And we're determined to bring the nation into this era on July 6th, our actual birthday. Mayor de Blasio has proclaimed it the Nation Day in a wonderful proclamation. We are launching a nimble, beautiful, innovative website. And you can say, but you know, the nation is now read in 12 different ways, 12 different platforms. And the journalism is what I care about, I think we care about, the writing. But to move it in different ways is part of what we need to do. And the demographics on the web, my friend was telling me the other day, who runs the website, the biggest demographic is 24 to 34. And I think you want to capture, not to sound like a member of the Catholic Church, which, by the way, as a cafeteria Catholic today, I want to say that that papal encyclical, I have just read the leaked version, but it's pretty amazing. And so you want to get them when they're young. The readers. Okay, so I'm going to end by saying that our great contributing editor, who has is in the special issue, Gore Vidal, liked to say that the United States is the United States of amnesia. He also liked to say that as a counter to that, the nation was a journalistic alert system. And in thinking about that, I just want to shout out to Chuck Collins, who is here, a great ally. In 2008, Chuck, who is at the Institute for Policy Studies and runs a responsible wealth and different programs tackling inequality, we did an issue 3 weeks before the financial crisis and 3 years before Occupy on the new inequality. And I think that is a measure of how the nation acts as a journalistic alert system and is in a position to kind of have a deeper analytical systemic view of things as a result. So I am going to wrap up and ask my colleague, and Alex introduced you, so I will not do that. But Don is also our brilliant correspondent in London, along with his partner, Maria Margaronis, who's been covering what's going on with Greece. Don covered the British election for us. In covering the British election—
Not a happy story for
you. Well, he had to cover former Nation intern, Edward Miliband, who was head of the Labour Party, and he gave a little less coverage to the other former intern, Nicholas Clegg, of the Liberal Democratic Party. Don will be covering the 2016 election in this country. He's heading to New Hampshire soon after this, where he says Senator Bernie Sanders is doing well in
Bernie,
the poll.
Bernie is doing well and making a lot of noise. We shall see.
Someone we've been covering for 25 years. Tell us, a little bit about the book, but tell us why you called it The Nation, a Biography.
Well, okay. I actually am a historian. I have a PhD in history from University College London, but I spent 20 years writing a biography of I.F. Stone. And so when Katrina rang me to ask whether I would be interested in writing this history of the magazine, I was terrified of taking another project that would take another 20 years, which I didn't have anymore. So part of the reason it's called a biography and not a history is because a history seems comprehensive. You have to do everything, speak to everyone, read every article in the archives. And I just said I didn't think I could do that. And then she said, well, what if you just did your take on it? And so it's partly a very personal take. And also, and this I have to say, it surprised me, but this was decisive. She said, we're thinking of it as an e-book. And so in a sense, it is a set of stories about the magazine. Each chapter focuses on a different editor. So it's very person-centered in a way, and that is very not true to the history, and that anybody who's ever worked at a magazine or a publication knows. It's not one person that puts it out, it's everybody together that puts it out. But you can tell a story by having a strong central character. So part of it is that biography lets you tell stories more. And it's more a collection of stories than a chronicle or a kind of, you know, comprehensive history. And part of it is that as an ebook, I saw it really as a kind of guided tour through 150 years of what you might call the hidden history of the United States, or an alternate history of the United States, or the history of the United States as it's passed through the pages of the nation, which includes a surprisingly large chunk of American mm-hmm. history, but not necessarily the history that you get in textbooks. So, you know, it includes things like the struggles in the abolitionist movement when the nation was founded. The nation was born in the middle of a fight, because the Civil War was pretty much won. But then the abolitionists were fighting between those who said, well, now that the Civil War is won, our job is done, we can go home, and those who said, no, we must keep fighting for full equality for the freed slaves. Now, of course, full equality for the freed slaves in 1865 meant full equality for the male free slaves. Nobody in 1865 was radical enough to imagine that women might vote. But the nation's founders were definitely on the side of full political equality for the freed slaves, but they were also straddling this split in the abolitionist movement, essentially between the followers of Wendell Phillips and the followers of William Lloyd Garrison. And the nation was born out of an attempt to bridge that split. It didn't last for more than a decade, really, but that's what gave it its initial impetus, was to find a place where those both wings could talk to each other. Mm-hmm. And in a way, to come back to your question, which I see I've wandered from a bit, by calling it a biography, I wanted to suggest that it had a kind of a life shape, a living form, so that, you know, we had a wayward youth, and there are definitely wayward years. I think the sort of the incident that marks the wayward years for me is I think it's 1886, when the Haymarket riots were in Chicago, and that they hanged these anarchists, and the nation at the time felt that they couldn't hang them fast enough. The nation was very much on the side of law and order and very much opposed to the threat of militant anarchism. So, you know, that's our wayward youth. Then we came to maturity, I would argue, after World War I, and full maturity during the time of the New Deal. And now we are in the prime of our life. So.
I was going to say one of the arcs from, and I want to follow up, but one of the arcs from the Haymarket and the hanging of the anarchists to the other case of anarchy. I'm thinking of Sacco and Vanzetti. There is an extraordinary editorial called Massachusetts the Murderer, which is a very powerful indictment by editor Oswald Garrison Villar, indicting the judicial system, indicting the governor of the state. Very, very passionate.
And it's in the anniversary issue, but in deference to local feelings, we won't read it.
We will not read it. But tell me, what was the most surprising? What surprised you most in writing the book?
Two things, really. One is I came to the nation in the 1980s, so I remember the fights over the Contras, mm-hmm. The fights over Nicaragua. I remember sort of vicious battles among the staff. You may remember some of them. But I thought that was just an artifact of our time. And so one of the things that surprised me was that there have always been no holds barred arguments between what today we would call liberals and radicals in the nation. And the nation has always been a place where those arguments have happened. Mm-hmm. And so I was surprised to see that happening in the 20s, in the 30s. In the 30s between the people who were supporters of Russia or who were allies of American communism versus members of the Socialist Party in the U.S. who were very anti-Stalinist, but whose domestic programs were pretty much identical. So they were able for a period during the Popular Front to work together in the nation, but that didn't mean they weren't constantly at each other's throats. Right. So that was one thing that surprised me. The other thing surprised me was, and this is left out of the history of the nation and also the history of our country, that from pretty much when it was founded until really the turn of the century, the nation was the house organ of the Republican Party. So I was astonished to discover how tied up the history of this magazine that I think of as this left magazine was with the Republican Party under President Grant.
Different Republican Party, but still, yeah.
different Republican Party.
Seeking but light here.
It didn't really part company with the Republican Party until the sort of Theodore Roosevelt wing came into the ascendancy. Roosevelt hated the nation. He said that if you read it too much, it could drive you mad.
Mental degeneracy.
it leads to mental degeneracy. And one of the reasons he hated it is because the nation refused to support the Spanish-American War, which was, of course, his path to glory and political fame. So I was surprised to discover how tied up with the Republican Party it was, and then after that, how reactionary it was. It was The Nation was a breeding ground for writers who later went on to form the National Review.
We are one of the few publications. I mean, it's now being overused, but the Espionage Act.
Yeah, we were prosecuted under the Espionage Act, and the magazine was banned from the mails for one issue because of an editorial by Albert J. Nock, who then later went on to edit The Freeman, which was a kind of libertarian magazine. And then when The Freeman folded, The Freeman's last major funder was William F. Buckley Sr. And when his son founded the National Review, he took on a lot of the staff from The Freeman, many of whom, Suzanne La Follette and Albert J. Nock, had been staffers at The Nation. So, you know, you think of it as a sort of 1960s, post-60s, second thoughts phenomenon.
Yes, yeah.
Crossing the aisle, as it were. But apparently it's been happening for a long time, and that surprised me too.
So, Chloe, these disputes may seem very distant to you, but you have been involved in pretty ferocious battles with trying to move this major institution, Harvard, to divest of fossil fuels stock. And tell us a little bit about your work and how you see your writing and journalism for The Nation intersecting with the activism you're doing on an issue of our time. And again, I don't mean to invoke the Pope too often, but that was I think, an extraordinary, it's going to be very hard, it seems to me, not just to editorialize for a moment, for climate deniers to have as their new adversary and foe the Pope. I can see on Fox now all the pundits bashing the Pope. But forgive, tell us about your work.
Yes. Well, first, I just wanted to ask, has everyone in here heard of the fossil fuel divestment movement? Yeah.
That's great.
Okay, so then y'all know that we are trying to get Harvard to sell its stocks in fossil fuel companies and reinvest in climate solutions. And this is now an international movement with over $50 billion in assets divested from fossil fuels. We're trying to stigmatize the fossil fuel industry, highlight their antisocial behavior, and really begin a cultural shift away from fossil fuels. So Divest Harvard started with three people, myself and two other young women, in the fall of 2012. Today, 3 years later, we have over 70,000 people that have signed on to our campaign. So it's been a huge, huge movement. And it's been absolutely just, I can't even believe how quickly it has grown. I remember a few months after we launched in 2012, I got an email from someone at The Nation, and my other co-founder got the email as well, and they asked us to write a piece. And within seconds of us receiving this email, she called me, and she was like, can you believe that The Nation wants to hear our story? And we were just blown away that someone would want to hear about our campaign. And I learned through my writing for The Nation the importance of really articulating this moment in history and writing this narrative. And I realized in retrospect that the reason why I was so shocked that The Nation wanted to hear our voices is because normally people don't want to hear from young people, that we're not seen as a source of authority. And I wrote about this in this issue, but you know, in this future that we fight for in the climate movement, it's about justice and equity and empathy and valuing all voices. But we're not doing that today. So I called for a radical now, living the values that we want to see in this future. And that I realized that is what The Nation was doing. They were looking at youth voices, and they were saying that what we had to say as people who are fighting for our future, fighting to highlight other voices that have been historically oppressed, that our voices are important and should be heard as well. And it was really through my writing for The Nation that I realized that.
I would love for Chloe to read just a few paragraphs from the piece she did for the special issue, but I wanted to just pick up on what you said. You know, so we have about 60 correspondents across this country on different campuses. We call it Student Nation. And embedded in that idea is what you said so eloquently, which is a belief that we need to hear your voices and to trust your eyes and ears and what you're seeing and feeling. And you know, we're also journalists, but I do think The Nation through time, whether it's trusting young people, but it's also covering movements in ways that other publications don't really do, because there's a willingness to immerse and not just parachute in, to listen to people and to listen not just to the leaders, but those in the movements of different kinds. But please, yeah, please read a few paragraphs if you would.
Okay. Couple modifications, because I wrote this when I was 22, but I'm now 23.
Oh, so it's going to be much more moderate.
We have to. That's very good.
Okay. I am 23 years old, and I have been a climate activist for 11 years. My call is for a radical future now. If we relegate new values to an abstract, theoretical future, then they will always remain there in the future. My radical now tries to bring this new moral framework into the present. Wave to the car that lets you cross the street. Wave more vigorously at those choosing to take buses and trains to work. The big things are equally important. Create fiery campaigns that allow for all interests and levels of involvement. Build a movement driven by love for, not fear of. What we love can't wait for the future.
That's beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. So will you read a little?
Sure.
And then
I'll read a little, but I'll tell you a story first, if I might, which is only partly in the book, and I'll read you the part in the book. But the story is really about the nation and Boston, because the nation could have been in Boston. In an odd way, it almost was in Boston, in the sense that it was founded by Frederick Law Olmsted, who later became a Bostonian, and in addition to designing Prospect Park and Central Park that New Yorkers know, he also designed the Emerald Necklace and other parks in Massachusetts. And he lived in Boston. His house is still here. It's a museum. E.L. Godkin, who was the first editor of The Nation, Godkin wrote that Boston is the one place in America where wealth and knowledge of how to use it are apt to coincide. So Godkin was a sort of a wannabe Bostonian. Although he was finally forced to choose in 1870 because Charles Eliot, who was the incoming president of Harvard, offered Godkin the professorship of history. And Godkin wrote to Olmsted saying, I'm inclined to take it if I could, if I can combine it with The Nation. But then the Harvard Corporation probably very sensibly said he had to cease all activities connected with The Nation if he's going to be a Harvard professor. Maybe they thought he would bring the university into disrepute. Anyway, he felt that given the choice between being a Harvard professor or editor of The Nation, he'd stay editor of The Nation. So there you go, Katrina.
Good.
For a long time, though, partly because Godkin has had this great admiration for Boston and for Harvard, there were a lot of connections. The first literary editor of The Nation, Wendell Phillips Garrison, was a Harvard 61, and he was the sort of person who, he was political. His father was William Lloyd Garrison, so he grew up in an atmosphere of controversy. But what he really cared about was typography and grammar. He said when the Harvard Monthly changed its typeface, he felt that the culture had declined. One of the other reasons that Teddy Roosevelt hated The Nation probably was because he was a member of the class of 1880. And in 1880, George Pellew, who was the class poet, he wrote the Hasty Pudding poem, and I'm going to read you the last few lines of that poem. Because the nation had become a cult among Harvard undergraduates. And the theme of his poem was that his classmates were too removed from the world. And he wrote, not indifferent then, wholly, is the Harvard spirit. Slowly we turn towards some high purpose, as the sunflower to the sun. Full of infinite suggestions is the mind that ever questions. Well, you know, it's that kind of poetry. And a noble faith inspires it when the questioning is done. Hail indifference, queen supremest of the pudding, thou that seemest mere languor to the vulgar. We know thee to be fair. May the puddings leave their nations and neglect their recitations to hear one sing the meaning of thy supercilious air. So,
it's good.
You know, even then, it gave you a sort of a dodgy reputation at Harvard to read The Nation. But I'm going to read just a bit from the beginning about how The Nation was started. And I think we also owe Boston an apology, because it was George Stearns who put up quite a lot of the money to start the Nation. And he was someone who was, he, you know, helped organize the 54th and 55th Massachusetts regiments, and was also one of the Secret Six. He was one of the co-conspirators with John Brown, and he actually paid for the guns at Harper's Ferry. And he was very unhappy with the Nation after it started. So he wanted to take his money back. He wanted to take about $10,000 back out of the magazine, and Godkin said no. So I feel that at the very least we could apologize. But shall I stand or shall I sit? What do you think? Can you hear all right like this? Okay. Slightly more comfortable for me, but I'll stand if you prefer. The Nation has many fathers. On June 25th, 1863, while Confederate forces under Robert E. Lee were still fighting their way north towards Gettysburg, a group of wealthy New Yorkers gathered at the Union League Club to hear a pitch. The speaker, Frederick Law Olmsted, was one of the club's founding members. Prevented by illness from attending college, Olmsted worked instead as a journalist, traveling through the Cotton South for the New York Times. And though he had no formal training as an architect, in 1858, he and his friend Calvert Vaux won the competition to design Central Park. With the outbreak of the Civil War, Olmsted became executive secretary of the United States Sanitary Commission, a precursor of the Red Cross. That evening, Olmsted laid out his dream of an honest weekly paper. The idea was to aim not for a large circulation, but for a select influential readership, the kind of people who would happily pay 15 or 20 cents a copy when the Times cost three. Although Olmsted promised that the paper should eventually pay its way, he told the men he was seeking a year's capital, some $40,000, not as an investment, but in pledges or donations. By the end of the evening, Olmsted had his first $1,000. By the end of the week, he had trustees, a fundraising committee, and an editor, his friend E.L. Godkin. "The thing starts so favorably," he wrote to his wife Mary, "I shall go into it strong, meaning to succeed." They had everything but a name. Olmsted considered the Loyalist, and in a nod to his sense of the importance of agriculture, his first book was called Walks and Talks of an American Farmer, he thought of calling it the Yeoman's Weekly. In all, he rejected 45 names for his new venture, including Godkin's suggestion of the Week. Part of the problem was that Olmsted had too many demands on his time. Gettysburg, though a great Union victory, left more than 14,000 Union soldiers who needed medical care, and Olmsted had to race off to tour the battlefield with General Meade. Meanwhile, his own position at the Sanitary Commission, where he was in constant conflict with his executive committee, had become unbearable. The New York draft riots in July, which raged right up to the doors of the Union League's clubhouse on 17th Street, made further fundraising difficult. But Olmsted was also impulsive, and when an offer came that August to manage the Mariposa estate, an enormous gold mine in California, he booked passage to San Francisco and turned the paper, as they still called it, over to Godkin, along with the $3,000 he'd managed to raise and a letter of introduction to Charles Elliott Norton. In September 1863, Godkin arrived in Boston. At 36, Charles Elliott Norton was only 4 years older than his visitor, yet he possessed everything the younger man wanted for himself, not just money and social position, but real literary authority, and most of all, a sense of being deeply rooted in American soil. The son of a Harvard professor known as the Unitarian Pope, and the grandson on his mother's side of the Boston banker Samuel Eliot, who was himself descended from the Eliot who served on the jury in the Salem witch trials, Charles Elliott Norton was precisely what his friend Oliver Wendell Holmes had in mind when he coined the term Boston Brahmin. Though he would later become the first professor of art history at Harvard, Norton was known chiefly as a literary impresario. In 1861, he'd helped his friends Henry Wadsworth Longfellow and James Russell Lowell to start the Dante Club, publishing his own translation of the Divine Comedy and the Vita Nuova. With Lowell, who was at the time editor of the Atlantic, he edited the North American Review, the country's first literary quarterly. His friendships included Thomas Carlyle, John Ruskin, Leslie Stephen, who was Virginia Woolf's father, and John Kipling, father of Rudyard. With Olmsted bound for the California goldfields, Godkin was very much in need of a friend. Godkin was born in County Wicklow, Ireland, a fact he kept to himself, and he'd acquired by his early 30s the appearance, education, and habits of an English gentleman. But the reality was a little bit more complicated. His father, James Godkin, was Dublin correspondent for the Times of London and a former Congregational minister. But James's own parents had been Catholic farmers. He converted before he married the daughter of a Protestant landowner. As editor-in-chief of the Dublin Daily Express, James Godkin had even been attacked for printing fabricated stories of sectarian violence by the political correspondent of the New York Tribune, one Karl Marx. So Godkin had graduated from Queen's College Belfast, trained briefly as a lawyer, and then went to Crimea to cover the Crimean War for the London Daily News. Of his undergraduate days, he wrote, "John Stuart Mill was our prophet, but America was our promised land." And in 1865, he set out for the United States, making a tour of the South on horseback, inspired by Olmsted, whom he'd met as soon as he landed in New York. In New York, he joined the New York bar, and he married Frances Foote of New Haven, who was the cousin of Harriet Beecher Stowe and Henry Ward Beecher. And her father, Samuel Foote, had retired as the president of the Ohio Life Insurance and Trust Company. So he had social ambitions, Godkin. And he now had financial security, but he wanted more. He turned down the offer of regular employment from Henry Raymond, founder of the New York Times, because he feared a clash between Raymond's political ambitions and the paper's independence. He also felt that his constitution wouldn't stand night work, and none of the evening dailies had a place for him. The paper project he'd inherited from Olmsted had been his last hope, but when his meeting with Norton produced only encouragement but not investment, he gave up. So in 1863, the paper ran aground and it was abandoned, except that it turned out Norton wasn't done with him. In April 1865, Godkin wrote to Olmsted to congratulate him on the great events of the last fortnight, that being the victory of the Union forces. Lee's surrender at Appomattox had left him dumbfounded, he wrote, and though he was thrilled by the Union victory, "I confess I should be very anxious about the terms of Reconstruction if Lincoln were not to be president for the next 4 years." The letter was dated April 12th, and long before it reached California, Lincoln was dead. Yet even as the nation was binding up its wounds and mourning the slain emancipator, the prospect of victory was tearing the abolitionist movement apart. This is the part I told you about before, between the followers of Garrison and the followers of Wendell Phillips. And in the midst of this battle for control, not just of the American Slavery Society, but for the future and the legacy of the abolitionist movement, James McKim, a Philadelphia activist with friends in both camps, decided to start a national weekly to carry on the work of the Liberator on broader ground. McKim was a Princeton graduate and editor of the Pennsylvania Freedman, and he was the person to whom Henry Box Brown, who was a slave in Richmond, Virginia, who had escaped slavery by mailing himself in a box north, he had mailed himself to McKim. He had been the recipient of Henry Box Brown. And in 1859, McKim and his wife had escorted Mary Brown to Harper's Ferry to claim the body of her husband. So he turned first to Philadelphia's Quakers and set about raising money. He tried to raise money in New York, but New York was a bastion of Copperhead anti-war sentiment during the war and had a lot of commercial links with the South, and it proved stony ground for fundraising. But networks in Boston and Baltimore soon put McKim in reach of his goal of $50,000, at which point he contracted George Stearns, a prosperous manufacturer and ship chandler from Medford, Massachusetts. Stern was one of the Secret Six who funded the raid on Harper's Ferry. In fact, Stearns was the legal owner of the 200 Sharps rifles used by Brown and his men. Commissioned a major during the Civil War, Stearns helped recruit the famed 54th and 55th Massachusetts African American Infantry Regiments. By April 1865, McKim had his funding. He also had a name for his new magazine, The Nation. Office space had become available at the former headquarters of the American Freedmen's Aid Union on Nassau Street in New York. But he needed a staff. McKim thought his daughter Lucy's fiancé, Wendell Phillips Garrison, the son of one abolitionist and the namesake of another, might make a suitable literary editor.
We should take some questions.
Yeah. Anyway, eventually he approached Godkin. He remembered that Godkin was looking around for a paper. He approached Godkin, and Godkin had to convince them that he was sufficiently sound on the question of suffrage for the freed slaves. And as you'll see if you read the book, he said he was sound, and he was sound for a few years, but then he began to backtrack a bit. And at that point, Stearns wanted to take his money out, and McKim basically kept the nation going and supported Godkin, who reorganized the magazine so he had total control over it. And they never gave poor Stearns his money back. So that's the embattled early history of the nation. But the only other thing I would say is that in writing the book and in researching the book, I became even more aware of something that I learned about when I was researching the life of I.F. Stone, which is the sort of long underground current of dissent in American life, and the fact that this dissent, it bubbles up from underground, you know, in times of crisis, but it needs settings and institutions to keep it going. And that, in a way, that's probably been the most important function of the nation over the 150 years, and probably for the next 150 years, is that it serves as a forum and a haven for dissenters, even at a time when dissent is dangerous. And so really, that's the thing that I think connects us to our history.
In praise of dissent.
Exactly.
In praise of dissent, want to take questions from you.
What was the nature of the disagreement between Wendell Phillips and Garrison?
Sure. The nature of the disagreement was Wendell Phillips, Garrison said, the slaves are freed, the 13th Amendment is passed, it's time to disband the American Anti-Slavery Society, our work is done. And Wendell Phillips said, no, not until we have a radical reconstruction of American political life, not until blacks are enfranchised throughout the South, and essentially the political class of the South is remade to put the country on a democratic footing.
In the special issue, there's an edited transcript of an evening we held at the Schomburg Library in New York, and the theme of it is toward a third reconstruction,
exactly.
Which is it's a very live concept today because of the assault on citizenship, on voting, on race, and Eric Foner is very much part of that forum.
Also, just to connect a little bit with something that Chloe said earlier, one of the things that that surprised me in researching this is that, you know, we talk about the hill to climb in terms of climate divestment and how deeply entrenched and how powerful the oil companies are, how much capital is tied up in the carbon extraction business. But, you know, in the 1860s, the largest single asset class in the United States was human capital, was
yes.
human chattel.
Yeah.
And those were entirely divested by the government and liquidated without any compensation to anybody. So it's interesting, if you look at the history, you can argue about whether it's wise to do that kind of thing. You can argue about whether it's the right thing to do. But there's not really any argument over whether it's politically possible because we've done it once. So it's worth bearing in mind.
Sir?
In the middle, sir.
In the middle and then to the right.
Yeah. Shortly after the divestment movement here, it was last month, I think, there was a three-person debate in the basement of the Department in the Kennedy School. I don't know whether you were there, but the gentleman whose name escapes me at the moment, who was arguing for divestment, later said that various brokerages and investment houses are actually considering the possibility that investments in fossil fuel energy companies may be stranded.
Mm-hmm.
That the price may go down so far that it actually would make sense now to avoid that eventuality by selling the stocks. That wasn't part of the argument. That was a coda. And I'm wondering whether you in the divestment movement are aware of this. This is actually a strategy that apparently is being advanced by certain parties in Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan. I was wondering if you're aware of it. I mean, this is like, you know, profit can be harnessed to in other words, if the fear is that the price would go down to like $30 or $20,
mm-hmm.
and if that can be encouraged through manipulation of technologies.
Right. Well, yes. One of the interesting things about divestment as a movement is that there are many different angles from which to approach it. So there's the moral angle, the religious angle, and the financial angle is actually incredibly strong. So that theory that you laid out, we call the carbon bubble. It's the idea that 80% of carbon reserves have to stay in the ground if we're to limit global warming to 2 degrees Celsius, which is the UN-mandated safe level. So that means that we're going to have some kind of climate policy that will limit carbon extraction and combustion, and B, that at some point fossil fuels will not become profitable, that our energy sources will switch over to other forms of energy. So, right now fossil fuels are valued so highly because we're planning on burning all of those reserves, which means that we're planning on cooking ourselves and the planet. So, it's an immoral bet. So we argue towards Harvard, and students across the world are arguing this, that if we really want to ensure that our endowments are invested sustainably and safely, that we can't be in fossil fuels.
I think over here.
Was somebody on the right side?
Yeah. I got to admit that the Nation magazine.
Is that Woody?
Yeah.
Oh, it's Woody. Hi, Woody.
It's such integrity, you being a cafeteria Catholic and yet giving atheists like me a sense of place, the sense stuff that you just talked about, Snowden and other people, the kind of things that you've done. But it wasn't until today when I read the piece about the Gawker unionization being organized, and then sort of dropped in the middle of it. It turns out your staff is organized by the Communication Workers of America.
The Nation?
Yeah.
So Don should speak to this, but the Nation, the Newspaper Guild was founded at the Nation, correct me if I'm wrong, Don, by Heywood Broun, who was a columnist in the 30s. The Nation has been unionized since that time. Our sister organization is CWA, but you raise, if I could just briefly, it's a fascinating week, it seems to me, for labor, because you have the story of the power of labor to stop this corporate-backed trade agreement. I would argue that labor had to work with civil rights, with enviros, with faith-based, with community groups to make that happen. But then you have this cover story, which we've done some of in prior years, cover story of the New York Times Magazine about Scott Walker's assault on labor and the decimation of public sector unions. And in those, but the difference is that labor on this trade agreement stayed together, hung together. In Wisconsin, Walker was able to divide them. Finally, the Gawker story is fascinating because it's this cutting edge, digital. But the poll I saw of the Gawker employees and 25 to 35, Chloe's younger than that, so she can't speak to that, shows that because of the financial crisis, because of the recession, because of debt, because of all these issues, that there's growing support among a younger generation now to join a union, which is a new phenomenon, but the alignment may be. How long is
The Nation's been in the Newspaper Guild since 1937.
Yeah, 37. Yeah.
But in a sense, because we were grandfathered in by Heywood Broun, who was the grandfather.
If you have one of my favorite pieces in this special issue is Heywood Broun telling us to stop being wusses. He thinks we're
too nice.
Wuss liberals, too nice.
Too nice.
Get on with it.
There's enough of this everybody has an opinion business. Yeah.
In that, all right. So Why don't we go left,
and
center,
then far left.
Left, center, right. Left, center, far, far left, yeah. Okay. Was there one on the left? If there's not one on the left, that sets a new trend.
Stand up, don't be shy. Stand up. Go ahead, stand up.
Naturally, on the question of the left, this gets to the question that you raised earlier of, I guess, the fight between liberal and radical.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, today some of us watch with horror the way in which the current administration is following in the footsteps of the previous administration, of pursuing a policy of regime change nation after nation, and now even saber rattling towards Russia and China. And I include this TPP not just as a corporate operation, but also as effectively trade warfare and trying to isolate China. And when it becomes necessary, facing the prospect that a democratic, nominally liberal president may be plunging us on the path towards a nuclear conflict with other nuclear superpowers, whether it becomes necessary to call for the impeachment of such a president?
I would call, and we are preparing, this country needs a debate about a radically different policy and engagement with the world, and the nation is the place to do it. As I said earlier, in terms of the war with Iraq, many liberals gave it their imprimatur, and many liberals are giving this horrific escalating proxy war with Russia their imprimatur. And in fact, it was. But you know, the nation, I will tell you, and I speak personally here because I've been writing about Russia, and my husband, Stephen Cohen, in the nation, has been vilified, castigated. I think as Don said, the nation becomes a space, a haven for dissenters who cannot get much of a hearing elsewhere, but that the tide will turn. But the argument has to be made. We have to be a place where we have that. I can tell you that last week, part of my role was in getting on a call with Representative Conyers, who was able to pass an amendment to the National Defense Administration legislation banning the training of these Azov battalions. Finally, let me just, we need a radically different national security policy. And with all due respect to Senator Sanders, who has been someone the nation has covered, has valued his position, the nation is going to editorialize and ask the candidates, certainly in the Democratic field, because I will say one thing, Rand Paul is one of the few. You can disagree with him on a whole slew of issues, but he is the one who's raising tough questions about our hyper-interventionist militaristic policies. But we're going to call on the Democratic primary field, because our position has always been that we wanted a robust, contested primary, not a, quote, coronation, but to really engage these issues and not kind of put them to the side out of fear of. One last thing, the Snowden op-ed, I think Woody Klein referred to it. It was very interesting. I thought one of the most interesting parts of that editorial was where at the end he had hope for a post-terror generation, that there would be an opening at long last as we saw the first diminution of state surveillance power since 9/11 with the passage of that USA Freedom Act first step, that we'd see a generation or an ability to engage the world not through the prism of the war on terror, the endless war, and what that does to our country.
The only thing I would add to that is that in terms of challenging presidents, whether it's by impeachment or by dissent and marshaling dissent, that in a way it's our history gives us a little bit of leverage. It gives us a little bit of confidence. You know, it's not the first time that we've disagreed with the White House if we disagree on this. It's not the first time that we've called a president to account.
Mm-hmm.
And so, in a sense, that's what gives the nation an ability to do things that maybe some of our younger, comradely publications can't do. Because it's not that we've seen it all and we're jaded. We're not jaded. We're outraged. But we have been here before. And so we have the confidence that comes from both confronting authority before and surviving through difficult times before.
And we're not supported by venture capital. Okay.
Front and center.
one last question.
Okay.
I think it's valuable to think about dissent, not only as confrontation, which we have a rich history of doing. However, it's the undecided voters who will decide things for us if we, and we have to be persuasive with those people. We can feature ourselves as standing up to various people who need to be confronted and powers, but the undecided voters are the ones who will help us most, not just the choir that we're preaching to. And I think that that we have an unprecedented segment proportion of undecided voters now. That means that the two extremes, if you will, can battle it out, but they're going to get very few of those people in the middle unless we think of persuasion.
So let me just, if I could, very briefly, because I'm fixed on this idea of transpartisanship, which isn't really bipartisanship, but there are a whole slew of issues these days where you have people working together. It's surveillance, the drug wars.
Immigration.
There's also, don't forget, you look at these polls, and I'm not big on polls, but majority support an increase in the minimum wage. Majority support expanding retirement security, finding ways to have debt-free education. And by the way, these are not socialist ideas, not that I'm against socialism. These are ideas that can be retrieved in our very own history. If Roosevelt gave his Economic Bill of Rights speech today, he'd be driven, well, he wouldn't now, which is the good news. 10 years ago, I used to say he'd be driven out of Washington. Today, he and Elizabeth Warren would be hand in hand. And, you know, you need to update and modernize. But I think the independent voters are overrated, with all due respect. And I think what we need to do is speak with humanity and speak in a different tone, speak in different ways, travel the country, not just coasts. But I do think there's a shift, a tectonic shift in this country. Bill Greider, our national affairs correspondent, just has a piece in the next issue. There's a very strong anti-establishment surge, not only in this country, but around the world. And I think in there, you'll also find undecided and independents. It's not necessarily a left-right issue. And the nation, as Don's book so beautifully tells it, is ferociously independent. It has been put, wouldn't you say, on the spectrum of progressive left, but it is independent.
I would say we are on the left now. We have been for a long time, but not sectarian and not adhering to any particular party or any single analysis. The thing about the magazine that is sometimes very unsatisfying to people is when there's debate on the left, let me take the hottest button issue I can think of.
Oh, don't.
Well, because we're closing, so we're not going to have time for an argument. Let's talk about BDS with sanctions, right? That's the hottest button issue there is for nation readers. And the thing is, there is no agreement. So if there is no agreement, we reflect the fact that there is no agreement. We have the debate. That's what we are the place to do that. You know, I don't think the question of raising the minimum wage is controversial among our readers.
No, but I'm saying it's a majority issue. Chuck Collins here could stand up and cite all the different measures of that. But I mean, years ago, the nation tried to get a conversation going with the Tea Party. Chuck, in fact, wrote something about let's work together. You know, big corporate power, big power. But I do think at the end, the anti-government racist tinge of the Tea Party negated that. But we're, you know, open to alliances. And I will say we do send all of the writers of the nation are out there on radio and not, you know, all kinds of media in order to speak and bring the ideas of the nation into the national debate. That's why, you know, Theodore Roosevelt, who was pre-MSNBC and radio or anything, but he, you know, understood the nation was a poll and a debate, and he may have thought it contributed to mental degeneracy, but it's out there and has to be reckoned with.
Can I just add something quickly to that? To answer that in a different way. Oh, I was having conversations with one of my friends. Her name is Kiran Gupta, just to give credit where credit is due. And she said to me that one of the reasons why she thinks it's so hard to mobilize people around climate change or divestment is because it's a strategy, not an identity. And other social movements like the women's rights movement or the civil rights movement, Black Lives Matter, it's around an identity. So then what I've been thinking about is, well, you know, there are actually a lot of issues today that are strategies, not identities, like money and politics, for example. And how do we create a shared identity around this? How do we integrate it into to our beings and therefore create a more broad-based movement? And as you might have heard from the excerpt that I read for my piece, I'm very big on love. And the place that I've gotten to is that we all have things that we care about, things that we will fight to protect. And if that is the base of our action, then it's a lot easier to mobilize people. If love is our identity, then we can mobilize around any issue. So I think that's how I would look at that.
Thank you. Thank you for coming out. Thank you. That's an article.
Yeah, that's my next one.
I get up every morning and I read the LA Times, and then I put my face in my hands and sob for about half an hour. Then I go to work.